Okay, we're back in business. The two clocks are functioning and locked. We have lots of beam current on both. And we're checking one versus the other, and they hover about a few nanoseconds. So we'll stay there for a day or two and see if it can maintain that measurement. Hello and welcome back. If you follow the channel, you know that we just repaired an HP5061A atomic clock. The goal is to compare two atomic clocks so we can directly check the general theory of relativity for ourselves. This is to celebrate the groundbreaking Hafele and Keating experiments of 1971, which did the first direct check of time dilation as predicted by the theory of relativity by flying HP5061A clocks around the world. The first step in the experiment is to check that our tired eBay clocks still operate within the required rate and stability when next to each other at rest in the lab. Later on, we'll be attempting to measure a shift of about 20 nanoseconds by bringing one of the clocks at elevated altitude over a few days, a shift 15 times smaller than in the original experiment. So our two clocks better be more stable than 20 nanoseconds over a few days to give us a fighting chance. But as you saw in the previous episode in the series, one of the clocks failed right on cue as I was about to measure it. Fortunately, we managed to repair it in said episode, or so we think, so let's try this measurement again. But first, let's look at the measurement setup. Hooray, we should now have two working atomic clocks. Which is man's worst nightmare? Which one is giving us the correct time? The answer is neither, and all we can do is to compare them to each other to give us an idea of their ultimate stability. But there is a slight complication. Hafele and Keating's clocks were equipped with an internal electronic divider that generated a sharp tick every second, an option recognizable by the Patek Philippe clock face on the front panel. Unfortunately, our clocks don't have that option. Ours are merely frequency standards. They just output very stable reference signals at 5 MHz, 1 MHz and 100 kHz. So to get our ticks, we need to enlist two HP59308A timing generators. We'll drive one with the 1 MHz from the first atomic clock, and do the same with the second one. The timing gens are fast, programmable digital dividers. We'll set them up to produce a 500 nanosecond atomic tick every 10 microseconds, representing each of the clocks. This will provide us with two atomic ticks, which we can observe on a scope. The interval between the ticks will be fixed, with an actual value that will depend on when the dividers randomly started. That interval should stay constant, atomically stable. We'll not be able to detect nor measure any changes on the scope itself. To observe the minuscule time drift between the pulses, we'll use an HP5334B counter instead. We will set it up as a time interval counter, measuring the interval from the first tick to the second tick. Using the counter's math function, we can zero out the mean delay and see only the variation. This counter should give us a resolution of 0.1 nanoseconds. Hopefully the result is not too noisy and will stay small, in the few nanoseconds range. To ensure that the counter is accurate, we will also slave it to one of the atomic clocks. Which leads to another complication. Our counter can only take a 10 MHz reference input, and our atomic clocks only have a 5 MHz output. Not to worry, we'll use the HP5087A clock distribution amp that we restored and upgraded in the previous episode just for that purpose. We'll take advantage of its newly installed frequency doubler option, feed it with 5 MHz, let the instrument double it, and use the resulting 10 MHz for the counter reference. Alright, this is one of those days when our previous HP restoration efforts pay off. We are all set with a glorious pile of vintage HP equipment that works. Let's measure atomic time. But before I get crucified by other time nuts in the comments, I should mention that the way adults characterize the frequency stability of a clock is by using the Allen variants or its modified alternatives. It gets mathematically complicated very quickly, but in essence, this is the variance of the clock frequency errors sampled over time tau. It's a statistical measure of the likely clock error after time tau, with tau of interest being a day in our case. It is expressed in seconds of drift per seconds of measurement, so it's a dimensionless quantity. A day being approximately 90,000 seconds or 9 times 10 to the 13th nanoseconds, if we targeted a drift of say less than 9 nanoseconds per day at 1 sigma, we'd want a clock with an Allen variance of about 1 times 10 to the minus 13th per day. According to the plots provided by HP, that is stretching what our old clocks can do. A day is about right here. It should be within the reach of an HP 5061A equipped with a high performance tube, but below what a standard tube can do. Plus, now we have two wobbling clocks instead of one, so we already know it's going to be dicey. But we'll try anyhow. Okay, we're back in business with our pile of HP measurement instruments. Clock A on the left versus repair clock B on the right. Currently trending about 2 to 3 nanosecond difference between each other. And we'll try to run that for a week and see if it stays there. If that's the case, then we can attempt measuring relativity for ourselves. I'm not too sure about that. We'll see.
The next morning.
And here we are the next morning, and the experiment half succeeded and half failed. It succeeded because the clock stayed locked. They are both on green. In particular, the right one would unlock before the repair. But they didn't stay that stable. They drifted 34, 35 nanoseconds. Which would be too much for a short duration experiment. The original experiment, they aim for 200 nanoseconds, but in our experiment, we're not going to fly it nor have it go around the world in opposite direction. So we'll accumulate a fraction of that, which will be less than minus 34 nanoseconds. I'll retry the experiment. Maybe they were not warm enough, maybe something happened. So I'm going to restart it. So right now they are 598 apart. So I'll enter this. 598. Minus 9, enter. And so it's reset. We'll let it run for another day.
The following day.
All right, we are doing a little bit better, and I have invited Einstein to the party because I am now running for a day. And it's only about 6.7 nanoseconds of drift, which is a bit much, still borderline, but much better than what we had before. And what I have done is actually I noticed that the drift was always in the same direction and always the same value. So I adjusted the C field in the clocks so that both match. It's very sensitive. It's sensitive to a graduation or half a graduation of the C field adjustment, which is that guy, which is already a fine pot over here.
The C field. You'd think atomic time is atomic time, and that is it. But it's not that simple. As we had seen in the Zeeman alignment episode, there is a slight variation of the cesium atomic line frequency due to the magnetic field, an effect discovered by Dutch scientist Peter Zeeman, and that bears his name to this day. Here is Zeeman in his lab with Einstein, by the way. Therefore, there is quite an elaborate procedure to adjust the magnetic field in the cesium tube, known as the C field, and we went through it in our Zeeman episode. But here we are pushing the clocks to their limits, and the standard adjustment is not precise enough to put the clocks right on top of each other. Mind you, in the Hafele and Keating experiment, they didn't even bother with that. They let the clocks drift with respect to each other. But they characterize each clock's drift versus a much more precise and much larger National Metrology Lab master clock.
Moving to the left.
Yeah. They then accounted for the drift to adjust the results afterwards. And by the way, they averaged the results of four clocks. Yes, they flew not just one, but four clocks. Sadly, I don't have access to a better master clock, and it is much more convenient if the clocks are not drifting versus each other to the first order to start with. I can then read the stability directly from this simple experiment. Anyhow, now that we have coaxed the clocks to more or less track each other, I want to record the variation over long periods of time, so you guessed it, I need to add a little bit more of HP equipment. So that's where we left off. We'll add the HP7132A as our chat recorder. It can record for days on long paper rolls. Now, it's an analog instrument, so we'll need the HP59501B digital to analog converter, which we conveniently repaired two episodes ago. We'll connect its analog output to the recorder. For good measure, we'll also add an HP3478A DVM, also repaired in a previous episode, of course, to monitor the DAC output voltage. Finally, we'll add the HP9816 computer to serve as our HPIB controller. It will pull the digital data from the counter and send it over to the DAC over the HPIB bus. All we need to do is to write a simple basic program, and our 100% vintage HP metrology setup is good to go. All right, we're getting fancier by the minute or the nanosecond here. So we have brought out my newest of my oldest computer. It's reading from the counter over here, the nanosecond tracking of the two clocks. And all it takes to automate the whole thing is 14 lines of vintage BASIC, no OS to load, no drivers, no version of Python to check, no libraries. The HP9816 handles all this natively out of the box. Line 10 defines a string that I just realized we don't use anywhere, so make this 13 lines of BASIC. Line 15 is the timeout for the HPIP bus in case we get stuck somewhere for more than 10 seconds. It will jump to line 500 and clear the bus and start again. Line 20 is reading the data from the counter at address 703. Line 40 scales it to get rid of the exponent. Line 50 halves it and centers it around 500 so it fits our DAC scale. Lines 60 and 70 make sure we don't exceed the valid DAC values from 0 to 999. Line 90 and 95 print the little summary line towards the bottom of the screen so we can check it's doing the right thing. Line 100 sends the scale value to the DAC at address 706, preceded by a 2 to indicate the minus 10 to plus 10 volt range. And that's pretty much it. So it's 8.4 nanoseconds, makes a voltage out of it, changes that into a command of our D2A box, that D2A transforms it into a real voltage, and then plots it on the chart recorder so we can follow the trends. So I want to figure out if it's trending one direction or if it's getting big skips.
The next morning.
Well, the result of the experiment is not great. We have drifted almost 14 nanoseconds. And not only there is drift, but the way it happens is really suspicious here. I have this big jumps. They happen, there's one here, there's one there. There's some here, it goes all direction. This is not going to get us there. Oh rats, this is not what I was expecting. This is going all over the place and even jumps, which is not normal. I don't know for sure, but I strongly suspect that it's one of the clocks, more likely the one we just repaired. There are more atomic gremlins hiding in that one.
However, there is one piece of really good news. The metrology setup, with its debauchery of vintage HP equipment, works perfectly. So fear not, we are not giving up that easily. We just need more work before we can check on our good friend Einstein. I can already sense more atomic clock repairs in our near future. So stay tuned for the next episode.